maybe may have you can say bad effects on his health. Now, in order to avoid this, the system thermostat has to know that the signal originated was authentic. So the point is, the origin of the source has to be authentic. In this case, IOTA gives you that possibility. So through its open network of nodes, IOTA allows you and your devices to use the network as source of truth and second transfer value in IOTA tokens, right? Sort of a cryptocurrency for that. So trust in IOTA, its integrity, security, and privacy. Second is real-time transactions. So there is no waiting time now, like 8 minutes, 5 minutes, nothing. It's real time. That means as soon as it happens, it will be recorded, it will be displayed. Plus, there is no fee involved. So zero fee. Real time, machine ready. Third is smart business models. So data driven. Now, what is data driven? So in order to create such a system, let me give you a very brief example. You have a sprinkler system installed at your home, and that sprinkler system is set to start at on Sundays and Saturdays on 8 a.m. right? So on Saturdays usually, or every day rather, 8 a.m. every day, 8 a.m. in the morning, 8 to 8:30 or 8 to 9 a.m. in the morning. On Saturdays, your kids want to play on the in the lawn and all, so you are in the garden, I mean in your house garden. So what you do is you stop the service on or manually override the service on Saturday. You do the same thing on Sunday also. So this is an anomaly for the system. So it detect that on Saturday 8 a.m. the machine or the sprinkler system was manually overridden and it did not start. Same goes for Sunday. So it will make a note, the artificial intelligence system or the smart system will make a note of this anomaly. The next week also that happens. So the consecutive two anomalies, it has to make a rule. So it will make a rule that despite on Saturdays and Sundays, the sprinkler system will not start automatically. So next Thursday or next Saturday, the owner doesn't or will not have to start or stop the sprinkler system manually. It will automatically not start. Maybe it can have a push notification to the owner that whether you want to start or not. But the point is, it learned on its own and it made a rule. So that is called data driven because it registered some sort of data and it made a rule out of it. Similarly, the same system, if I say that I want to predict, I'm a manufacturer of some product and I want to predict the next sale or the next month's sale or the next year's sale or what do I do or where is my money going or something like that, if there are any fraud, all these things which run on numerical data on base on the basis of statistics are called data driven applications because the core or the driving force of these sort of applications is data, right? So the point is, data allows you to make decisions. Same way, let's say I'm just giving a very simple example that in winter or before rainy season, most of the people get their car or vehicle serviced. The reason is pretty simple. Why? Because the past data suggests that if you do that, if you get your car or your vehicle serviced during the rainy season, and because they oil the entire engine, I mean, for cars it is not much an issue, but for bikes it is a huge issue because if you do that, the engines are already an open. So what happens is, if the oil gets mixed with water, your engine or your bike will be in trouble. And that is the reason that most of the bike users get their bikes serviced before rainy season and they get it serviced after rainy season so that every mud or dust particles can be removed. So the point is, why that decision was taken? Because the past history, I mean to say, the data suggested that this should be taken care of before the rainy season starts. And that is called data-driven applications or data-driven technologies. Open innovation, that means it is like currently what happens is this IOTA is, I'm not saying that it is a good technology or bad technology, but it is still, they have to go a long mile. So that is an open innovation. That means people can use it for their different innovative purposes. People should use it because it is free. There is no fees involved and everything around it so that you can go ahead. Permissionless ecosystem. As we yesterday even saw that if you want to put something over, you can say Ethereum, then you have, and in order to commit a transaction, you need to pay a small gas fee. Now, if I don't want to pay right now, so that is because, but it is, again, it is a permissionless. We saw that Hyperledger Fabric is a permissioned network. That means these X509 certificates and all CA and MSP and everything will be in picture. But here, that is completely not necessary. So that is a permissionless ecosystem. Who is IOTA for? So IOTA can, like, anyone who does not trust centralized networks, like we discussed yesterday, what are the issues with centralized networks? Anyone who wants to secure or who wants to secure their data, right? Now, IOTA networks, peer-to-peer controls when there is no central authority, similar to blockchain. But point is pretty simple, that it doesn't work exactly like blockchain. And I'll share that information within a few minutes. I'm not going to ruin the surprise, but the point is it doesn't work exactly like blockchain. I'm building your mindset that we have seen yesterday blockchain. There were some flaws in the technology, and these technologies are built to remove the flaws on the system, but to leverage the power of blockchain in terms of distributed ledger technologies, that is DLT. So anyone who wants to transmit some data, but he wants to, like, all the nodes hold have to have a copy of the entire transaction, then anyone wants to secure their data. Anyone who values security, of course, everyone does that. Anyone who wants to freedom to transact, that means you don't need to pay a subscription, you don't need to sign a contract, you don't need to pay the gas fee or anything like that. So that is how it works. Now, how does it work then? If that is not the case, if you are not going to pay a gas fee, then miners, then how will miners mine the transaction? How will the transaction will be added? If I am not getting any money, why would I, you can say, validate a transaction from some which is generated by someone else by investing my own time? Of course, there is a question, because in Ethereum, the question is pretty simple. I am earning some money in terms of gas fees. Here, that entire layer is gone. So what happens then? So IOTA architecture involves the following components. First is nodes. Second, of course, nodes is the core part, or node is the core part of the any blockchain solution. Tangle. Tangle is a different network. Now, let me just give you the miners. Let's say you want to have a transaction, or you want to submit a transaction to IOTA. So what will happen? You will be given two transactions to validate, two random transactions to validate. Once you do that, your transactions will be validated automatically. That means you have done some work, but you have not paid any fees, and your transaction is recorded. And that entire system is known as Tangle. That is replicated across all nodes in an IOTA network is known as Tangle. All data in Tangle is stored in the objects called transactions. Once the transaction, again, is attached to the Tangle, it cannot be changed. That means it is immutable, similarly like blockchain. So if you want to update, then it is again an insertion, so that it will create a new transaction all alone. Now, clients. So clients, who are the clients? The persons who are the people who are using it, the persons who are attached to that particular IOTA network, like my device is sending data. So I am as a person, and my device is sending the data, so I'm attached. I'm a client for IOTA network. Right now, the Tangle is the distributed ledger in IOTA that contains an up-to-date history of transactions. So basically, it is like, for us, it is Hyperledger Fabric, because Hyperledger Fabric is the ledger or distributed ledger which holds everything for us. It's a single source of truth. That means it is same across the globe. Now, yesterday what we saw is it's a permission network. So maybe if I have deployed a solution, for me it is a different story. For you, have deployed a solution, for you it's a different story, because both the things are pretty much different to each other. But here with IOTA, it's a public network, so it is similar to Ethereum. So it is same for everyone on the globe. Any client anywhere in the world is able to send valid transactions to any node, and the transaction will be replicated across the rest of the network to form one version of truth. It is known as the Tangle. Now, yesterday also with Ethereum, we saw that the same thing is also happening with Ethereum. But the point is with IOTA, you are not paying gas fees, and it is quick. So these are two differences which separates IOTA from Ethereum. Now, DAG, I have like directed acyclic graph. Now, what is the directed acyclic graph? DAG is, as I told you before, one transaction is connected to two different transactions. So over here is able to, like, because every transaction you want to create or you want to submit to the IOTA node, at the same time you have to validate two more transactions. That means every node is performing the same duty. Every node is validating the transaction, or and every node is submitting the transactions, right? So using DAG, in IOTA language, it is Tangle, but for us, let's say it is DAG, then IOTA is able to assign the same exit duties to every member, right? So as I told you before also, that it is, once again, one transaction you want to commit, you have to validate two more transactions, right? You have to approve two more transactions. But the point is, it looks something like this. Each transaction in the graph is represented by a box, and each attachment is represented by a line. That means here for us, this is a transaction and this is an attachment. So when a new transaction is attached to the Tangle, it is attached to two previous transactions, adding two new lines to the graph. So let's say hypothetically, the 6 is added to 5. So 5 is then it is added to 2 and 5 is added to 3. So that means ultimately it is a network of 3 transactions, right? Then references. So just in order to understand it better, transactions are attached to the Tangle by referencing other transactions in their branch transactions and trunk transaction fields. Now, one reference is direct, the other is indirect. So let me just tell you that. Transaction 5 directly references transaction 2 and 3. So let us check here. 5. Yes, it is directly connected to 2 and it is directly connected with 3. So as soon as somebody is going to submit this transaction 5, he has to validate or approve transaction number 2 and transaction number 3. So that is a DAG, that is a Tangle across that particular transaction. Indirect. So connects a transaction with those for the in its branch transaction and trunk transaction field. That means it is before that. So for example, 6 indirectly references 3 through transaction 5. Let us see that. 6 indirectly references 3 through transaction 5. So 5 for 5, 2 and 3 are direct references, but for 6, 3 is an indirect reference, because this is again a 3 direct for 6, 5 and 3, because there are 3 transactions attached to each other. Same goes for 4, 2 and 1, 0, 1 and 3, 2, 1, 3. All these transactions, every transaction has to be connected with two other transactions in the context of either direct or indirect transactions or attachments, right? So the direct references are its parents and indirect references are its grandparents. It is just terminology for us to understand easily, because it affects our lives. So these are the two hash which will be generated once you do that, or once you check the block structure.
Yes, two more. મને કે તમે સીધા સાહેબ ના પાણી મને બહુ દુઃખ થયું છે મારો મૂડ મરી ગયો
હેલો સોરી સર હેલો સુનિલ સર Sunil sir, you can unmute your mic. Hello.
Cannot hear me. Hello.
Yes. Okay, sir. Sorry, yeah. Sir. There was some internal noise. Sorry.
No problem. So when we check the Tangle Explorer in a while, we will be able to see these parents, trunk and branch. So trunk is basically the main directly connected, and the branch is maybe you can say indirectly connected, right? Now, again, as I told you before, that these technologies today, what we are going to discuss are either blockchain or non-blockchain, but practically they are not completely following the blockchain principles. So blockchain and Tangle both fall are the same category of distributed ledger technology. Then how are they different? The main two differences between blockchains and the Tangle are, the Tangle has no transaction fee, as I told you before, and IOTA network has no miners. That means there is no waiting period. There is no mining a particular transaction. There is no environmental issue. Plus, apart from this, still, because every other transaction currently exists in terms of cryptocurrencies, there is a gas fee involved. There is these mining algorithms or mining consensus mechanisms involved, which is a huge risk to environment. And that is why even Ethereum has started to move towards a different, you can say, proof of stake algorithm rather than mining algorithm, rather than stick to proof of work algorithm. So the point is, because these issues were there, that gave rise to IOTA. And that is how Tangle is different from other blockchain networks who are, again, permissionless and public blockchain networks. So in the blockchain data structure, the blockchain data structure consists of a chain of sequential blocks. We have seen this yesterday. And each block is able to store a limited number of transactions. As a result, whenever a new transaction takes place, you can attach only to a single place. That means to a single block. Once that block is filled, it will automatically migrate to a new block. So what happens is, because of this limitation, blockchain networks often experience slow confirmation times, because as we have seen yesterday, or we have discussed yesterday, it takes 8 minutes for Hyperledger. It is permissioned network, so it is almost immediately like this. But for public networks, it always takes time. And this bottleneck, or blockchain bottleneck, is removed by IOTA. Right. So this is a graphical representation of how a new transaction is added, or how a new, as you can see, only one can be attached to a single block. And that means one transaction is attached to a block and we move on. And that is why it is a bottleneck, because at the same time, only one transaction can happen. But the Tangle data structure is different. The Tangle data structure is a direct-led acyclic graph where each transaction is attached to two previous ones, as we discussed, in the direct or indirect mode. So rather than like limited to a single place for attaching new transactions, there are now technically two different places through which you can attach your transactions, as one transaction is always attached to two more transactions. So which removes the time limit in confirmation times. Now let us see the graphical representation of that. As you can see, every new transaction is attached with two previous transactions, so that the bottleneck is now like you can say similar to what do you call serial, and before serial it was like serial is same line, and then multiple you can say blocks can be, or multiple transactions can be attached at the same time. So the point is, the confirmation time is, the waiting period is gone, and that's why the transactions in IOTA is real time, so that it allows you to record a transaction real time, because it is mainly designed for Internet of Everything, because internet sensors or the IoT sensors produce a huge amount of data, and there cannot be have any latency during this particular transaction record time. And that is the reason that IOTA is slowly picking the pace in the market. Now, how do you send transactions from your particular node, or whatever we want to record your sensor data, to the public node? So first step is choose your IOTA network. Second is getting tip transactions. Third, of work, and sending the transaction to a node. And let us see. Now, this is again a graphical representation of how this entire network follows. So IOTA network, let's say DevNet or mainnet, then getting TIM transaction. Those are two other transactions doing proof of work. So you can say endorse your transaction and send the transaction. So IOTA networks, there are two networks. Again, it can be IOTA networks also can be private or permissionless. So private networks access the Tangle, which requires permission from the network owner, because if you have created the same way, it is like hybrid cloud, a public cloud and private cloud. So public cloud is open to everyone, but private cloud you have to go through particular channels and all. So, but these private clouds are mostly run by companies or individuals who want to test, you can say, an application in the environment, local environment, sort of a beta testing before going to the market, so that they can identify the risks involved, they can identify the issues or the bugs quickly so that when they go to full, you can say alpha release, there will not be any issues. So, and then permissionless networks, of course, because it's a public network, so it is free or it is open to everyone, and transactions you send in these networks are visible to anyone. These networks are made up of nodes from all over the world, and anyone is free to join the network, similarly to Ethereum. Official permissionless networks are two, mainnet and devnet. The mainnet is, again, as we have seen yesterday, for Ethereum also it is mainnet. And for developer network, there are Rinkeby, Robston. These are all three, four different Ethereum test networks also. Here it is devnet, right? In devnet, the IOTA token has no value, but in mainnet, the IOTA token has value, right? So that is like you can have trading platforms like cryptocurrency exchanges. So mainnet, but today, because it is all, I cannot cover everything in 1.5 hours. So I've like you can say, followed the main features of why IOTA is different than the other rest permissionless blockchain technologies. Then community permissionless network. So there are two networks, but one more, that is a community permissionless network, and that is Comnet. Comnet is a developer network where IOTA token has no value except for testing purposes, similar to DevNet. So we are, the demo which we are going to see today will be shown you on a DevNet node or DevNet network.
Sir.
Yes.
So there is one question from participant. Yes,
go ahead.
Does IOTA has smart contract?
Yes. We will see in a while. Excuse me. Excuse me. Sorry. So consensus in a blockchain, this one. So in blockchain, the network is split into miners and users. So who are the miners who mine the transactions? It will take, let's say, 8 minutes, 5 minutes, 4 minutes, 2 minutes, whatever. And miners consume large amount of computing power. That is POW, which we have seen. Miners are incentivized in terms of they get the gas fee or the portion of gas fee. The only way to reverse transactions in a blockchain is to mine a new blockchain in the time limit. So it takes other miners to mine a single block. So to do so, a miner would need 51% of network's ability to do the proof of work known as hash power. What I read right now is like 3-4 lines. Can anyone tell me what is this exactly, or what does this mean? You can read the line again. It's the second last paragraph. The only way to reverse a transaction in a blockchain is to mine a new blockchain in the time it takes other miners to mine a single block. To do so, a miner would need 51% of the network's ability to do proof of work known as hash power. Can anyone tell me what does this mean? Any idea? Doesn't need to be right, but any idea. What does it mean? Payal, you can try. Am I still audible, right? Hello?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, okay. So the point is, yesterday I told you that in blockchain network, everything is immutable. That means nothing can be changed. But if somebody on the public network wants to do a malicious attack and wants to change or wants to reverse a transaction, then it will need the 51% of the computing power of entire network. That means practically it is not possible to change or to update any transaction in Ethereum or in a public blockchain network, because you will require the consensus mechanism is set more than 50%. So you will require the computing power which does that. And even if you accumulate that much power, then the pricing is not enough. I mean, whatever you gain, you will not be enough to invest that much of money. And that's why till today, as I told you yesterday also, that till today the hacks happened, but because of nodes, the security is not compromised. But the point is those, that money is not still be converted or could not be converted into fiat currencies, right? So this is how it works. And that is why it is said that blockchain is technically virus free, blockchain is technically tamper free, blockchain is immutable. You cannot do anything because of this particular principle, which is coded in terms of smart contracts into blockchain networks. Right? As a result, requiring proof of work secures blockchain networks by making it difficult to attack, change, or stop. So the more miners that mine, the more secure the network. Very simple. Because then the number, let's say if there are 10 miners, then I can have 6 machines power. That is fine. But if there are 100 miners, then I will need 51 computers. If there are 1,000 mines, then I have 501 computers. So the point is, the more miners are there, the more secure the network. That means the more people are consuming the network, the network is getting more and more secured. And that is the power of decentralized finance, or DeFi, or decentralized technology. Now, the same way, the consensus in the Tangle works in a different way. In the Tangle, transactions require, again, no fees because the network has no miners. So proof of work here is not used to secure the work. Instead, it is used just to discourage spam transactions. To reach a consensus, all IOTA nodes validate transactions and use the coordinator to decide which ones are confirmed internally. The coordinator helps to secure the network by making sure that only valid transactions are confirmed. Again, there is not enough information or enough work you will see on this, because the coordinator is temporary, as again it is limited to coordinator. That means it is again a central piece, which is a limitation of blockchain. So that is the reason that they are working on a different angle right now. Core decide, but again they have not yet implemented, so there is no point in understanding how coordinator works and all, because it is going to be changed soon by the IOTA developers. So the point is, again, the network is free to use. Even in terms of transactions, there are no miners and there is no mining activity happening. The only mining activity or only validating transaction activity happen is done by coordinator to validate the transactions. Now, let us see the demo. Now, the installation process, yesterday we saw almost 40 to 45 steps, but today you are safe. The installation is pretty simple and it can be done within few minutes. So just give me a moment, I'll open my browser. So you can hear, you can see that the first smart contract is given to you. Before that, you have to set up your developer environment. So first, install your tools. Second is create your coding project. And third is install the IOTA Core client library. It is again JavaScript, so there is not much an issue. You have to use Node.js. That is again, most of the computers nowadays have Node.js and Visual Studio Code installed. I have installed both of them. And then what you have to do is you have to create your first coding project. So you can make a directory like this, which I've already created. So I can just, if you want to create one more, I can do that also. Like IOTA Hello World is already I've created. Over here, I can create new directory, like new directory IOTA demo. Then I will just move towards that directory IOTA demo. Then what is the step? The step is npm init. That means you are initializing a new Node.js project. So I will write npm init. And then it will ask, the package name is IOTA demo. That is fine. I'll agree with that. Version is 1.0.0. If you want to change, you can write down a number over here. Description, it is a test. Entry point index.js, that is fine. If you want to have a new name or new file name, you can enter that file name over here. Test command, none. Git repository, none. Keywords, none. Author, you can say Sunil Kapadia. License is fine. So we have created a project. Just type in yes and you are good to go. The project is created. If you see the directory part, you will be able to see that package JSON is created. That means the package JSON now has whatever information I've just put down. The package is containing packet.json is having that information. So what is the next step? I need to install something over here. So let us go there. Install the IOTA Core library. So what will I do? I will write down this command over here. let us wait for a while. Yeah, so it has to have like this. If you want to just move over, that it works like this. It's an IOTA converter 1.1.0.0 beta 30, IOTA core 1.0 beta 30, and then found zero vulnerability similar to this. Added 19 package from 10 contributors, but added here it is 25 packages from 16 contributors. Because when you try, maybe now we are good to go. So we are done. Now, what is that? Hello world. So first application. So Sandra, this code, let me just explain you that code and then we will run in a detail mode. So require the library and connect to a node. So that means this is the library we are going to require. Require IOTA code. Then create a new instance of the IOTA API project. So that is IOTA, it is Compose API, and we are sending or we are using this API. Now, if you remember, this is a DevNet API. That means we are not moving or we are not sending anything to a live node. We are just sending to a dummy node. So that is your Compose API, but a DevNet API. The constant depth is 3. That means you are going to connect with two more transactions. So that is why depth is set to 3. One transaction, your own transaction, and two more, 3. Constant minimum weight magnitude. Now, minimum weight magnitude is a number, 9. The number tells you that whenever you want to submit a transaction, because all the other nodes also have to verify your transaction, and you will be going to verify two more. If you keep this value very low, the transaction will be discarded. So it has to be enough to that the transaction seems valid. And that's why here the minimum value is 9. So you have kept 9. Then define the address where you want to send the message. So this address is again is a dummy address, so that does not belong to anyone. It just consists of 81 trites. Now, what is a trite? I'll explain you in a while. Then a seed. That means this seed is not used in this code because this lab, but we have to have a seed defined in this particular thing, and that's why we have a dummy seed involved in this code. Then the message you want to send. The message is json.stringify message hello world. So it serializes the message into a JSON, and the message in trites, so converts to that particular message, a JSON serialized message is converted to trites. This transaction is again the constant, the variable, or the, you can say the message which is going to be sent to that particular address is value 0, address and message is message in trites. That means what will be the message? Hello world, right? So what we have seen once again, here we have installed at this place, we have installed the required library packages. Here we are using the API because the node is not in our machine, the node is on the DevNet. So we are using the API. Here we have set the depth to 3, which is the minimal value. And here also we have the weight magnitude, we have set to 9. Then we have, because it is a transaction, so the next party's address is also required. So that is this address. Currently, because your node has to be also the main value, so that is your seed value. Then your hello world, the message which is converted into trites, and then finally the entire variable in terms of a block or in terms of a class, which is having three different variables. First variable is zero value, which is zero, address is address, and the third one is message in trites. Now, if you then you want to have the transfer. So then IOTA prepare transfers, seed and transfer. That means who is sending and what is transferring, what is getting transferred. And send trites to trites with the following depth and minimum weight magnitude parameters. Then it goes to bundle, and then if any sort of error occurs, then the console will be able to display that error to you. And then you can just execute the file, right? So, and after that, what happens? Just let me show that. So what will I do? I'll have this index.js over here. So let me just open folder IOTA demo. Where is it located? IOT Hello World, inside IOT Hello World. So I'll go to my C drive. I'll go to MSI. Sorry, I have to go to users and then MSI. So I'll go to users, I'll go to MSI, I will go to IOTA Hello World. So that is the folder somewhere here, IOTA Hello World. And even in that, it is IOTA demo. So I'll just select this folder. Save. Okay. So now we can see that in over here, there is no index.js file. So I'll just run the terminal first over here. Okay, terminal is there. Now I will add a file over here and I'll name that file index.js, right? And now I'll step by step copy paste the entire code, which was here. Now at the bottom also the entire code is written. So I'll just copy from here. So that I don't have to copy one by one, and this is done. We are good to go, right? You will have this sort of error over here, but ignore it. That doesn't mean anything. Now, what was written in that particular thing? That you have to run the command. You have to initiate the command. So node index.js. Now, here, if you can see, there is a one little notification over here. The file is unsaved. That means after doing that, you have to save the file first. And then you can run node index.js. Hopefully it should run. Yes, it ran. Now you will be presented with a hash. So just copy this hash, Control C. Let us go to the Explorer. That is the node Explorer or the block Explorer. That is an utility from IOTA. Now what you need to do is, just a second. Paste that hash over here. Select the transaction, but instead of network mainnet, select devnet and click explore. So you'll be able to see that's a confirmed transaction and your message is over here. Message hello world. Right? So what we have seen is we have seen that how a simple transaction can happen with minimal set of installation. We were able to send our transaction to the devnet. Now, let's say you don't want to install anything at all in your local machine, anything at all. Then there is again, if you just want to test it, then there is repl.it. Over here, you can do the same thing. You can, as you can see, I have like created this index.js and I have installed that npm IOTA core library. And when you just run, or don't even type that, just click run. It will run. And again, it created a new hash for us. Why? Because it was there. Again, the transaction was done from REPL. And if I go to again this utility, I paste that particular hash over here. I change the network to devnet. And if I click explore, once again, what will happen? I will end up into the message hello world over here, right? You will be able to see the parents also. Trunk is this one, branch is this one. That means it is attached, or this transaction is attached with two different transactions. That is the proof of that. The nonce is a, you can say a random number, which is there to for the very verification or validation of the transaction. The weight, as we said, 9, right? And this is a raw text, which is the trite, which is that hello message was converted into this one. And then it is converted for us. It is this one, hello world. But for them, it is converted to trite. So it is this one, and which is basically useless for us to even check that line. For me, it is that I was successfully able to send the message hello world to the DevNet network using both the ways, from my system as well as from using the REPL, which is an online system which allows you to create node packages or node projects over here, and then it allows you to run this entire IOTA network even without typing anything, right? So that is, you can say, that is everything around you can say IOTA. If any question is there, you can ask. Because now I'll start Coda. But if you have any questions regarding IOTA, please go ahead.
Yes. Is there any question from any participant regarding IOTA?
Hello.
Yes.
Sir, I have a question regarding Explorer, not IOTA.
Okay.
You last time in I think in last lecture you shown one page where you use Explorer. Can we use that Hyperledger Explorer for fabric applications?
Yes, that is also possible. You can use that, but for that you need to have that machine, virtual machine or Linux machine, so with a UI interface. Otherwise, because whatever I showed was using Bash, that is a command line interface. So we cannot explore, but for using that, you can explore if you do that, because Hyperledger Blockchain Explorer is also available. But again, as I told you before, it gives you an idea because it is a permission to network. So practically, it is not that useful.
Okay, sir. Okay. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else?
Hello?
Yes.
Hello, sir. Can we have our own app? For example, if you have created our own dApp and if you want to connect that dApp with the IOTA network, so is it possible?
Yes, by all means possible. It is the way the entire world is developing, because what I have done, we have done a Node.js application, right? And we have written some code. But let's say if it is connected to a UI, then of course at the core it will work like this. But for the user, it is always a website or a mobile application or something like that. That is the beauty of it, that it is layered. So the UI layer is separate. You can create your own separate UI layer in whatever format you want, and then you can connect. And that is why the way we connected through an API. If you have seen the code, let me just open that page again. Hello world. Over here, there is an API. Now APIs can be called from anywhere, right? So this is with the port number 443. So that is, by all means, it is possible to have a dApp. Anyone, or should I move just to the Coda portion?
Sir, you can move.
Okay. Okay, the last thing was remaining, trides. So all transactions which are having characters called trides. These trides are part of ternary numeral system. In IOTA, data is represented in balanced ternary, which is consist of 1, 0 and minus 1. These values are called trids, and three of them are equal to one trid. And that is how the entire transaction converts to numbers. And that is why it is extremely, or it is impossible to get back to the original value. And that is how the trids work, or that is how the transactions are encrypted. Now, the next portion is Coda. Now we have seen that IOTA has removed the limitation of mining, the limitation of waiting, and limitation of latency, transaction time periods also. Here, the Coda is in the same line. It started as a mainly to help the finance world, but it is more than that. And currently, like people, this is the third blockchain network which is in extremely demand. First one is, of course, Ethereum. The second one is Hyperledger. And the third one is this one, Coda. Hyperledger for permission networks, Hyperledger rules the market. For public network, Ethereum rules the market. But second most favored public network is Coda. What is Coda? So Coda is permissioned distributed platform for businesses. Popular domains are finance, supply chain, any other platform which you fit suitable for blockchain. The main thing is single global database. So possible. The idea behind Coda is it stores everything. Whatever you are supposed to have in terms of business, it can store everything. So point is, let's say your contracts, your liabilities, your skill sets, your whatever you are required to do a business. That means if a contract which is written in Ethereum or Hyperledger Fabric, it is not legally bound, but a contract written in Coda is legally bound. And that is the difference between Coda and the other previous two blockchain networks which we have seen. Now, the biggest benefit using Coda is data shared between the concerned nodes only. That means if I let's say a node A sends some data to node B, right? There are three nodes, A, B, and C. Now data, some data is being sent from A to B. Then the transaction will be visible between only these two nodes, and C will not be even aware of that particular node, right? So there is no POW, POS, there is no mining mechanism, or there is no consensus mechanism to finalize or to commit the block. Notary is a special node which finalizes the entire set of transaction. And that is the reason that Corda is highly scalable. There is no broadcasting of transactions to each node. Even in IOTA, the transaction is being broadcast to each and every node. But in Corda, that is also not the case. In Corda, if let's say there are four nodes, A, B, C, and D, and only the transactions are happening within A and B, then C and D will not be even disturbed. They will not be aware of the transactions happen. UTXO model. So that is unspent transaction output prevents double spending. Any one of you can tell me what is a double spending attack or what is a double spending issue in with all the Ethereum and Bitcoin's network? Anyone?
Yes, if we example, if we sell one entity or one token to two different participants.
Exactly. So thank you very much for the answer. So the point is, it is a perfect answer in terms of double spending. That means I have 100 rupees in my account. I'll send it to person A, and the same transaction I will do with person B. So the money is same 100. So how can I transfer 200 rupees for two different persons? So one person 100, the other person 100. That means I have double spend issue. That means within these networks, there is a possibility that it can happen. So how it can be resolved is, let's say person A sends some data to person B or sends 10 rupees to person B. Now the person B is, the person A is having 15 rupees. So 15 rupees, 10 rupees will, the transaction of 10 rupees will be marked as consumed, and 5 rupees will be marked as unspent. So, and the 5 rupees will be transferred back to person A. So what will happen is, person A cannot use the value which is already sent to person B, and that is 10 rupees. And that is how they spend, or they prevent these double spending attacks. And that is how code, that is why Corda is highly scalable, as well as you can say it removes the possible attacks, even the possible attacks in Ethereum or other network. Maybe Ethereum, I believe, doesn't allow that, but for previous to Ethereum, those transactions or those networks allowed that. But whatever network uses UTXO model, they are able to prevent these double spending attacks. Benefits of Corda network. So first and by far the most important is interoperability. The exchange of data or assets via secure and efficient internet layer. And it is like it in a way that isn't possible with separate isolated Corda networks. So a common trust route surrounds all transactions, and a consistent set of networks parameter ensures all participants may transact with each other. It is not compulsory, it is may. As I told you before, the transaction visibility is limited to no basis. The network will support many subgroups of participants running particular Corda apps, or sometimes referred to as business networks. For us, let's say I want to have a Corda network, but my business logic is different, or my business logic is in my UI, or my UI is different, the entire interface is different. My business, maybe I want to separate that from blockchain, maybe I want to put that business logic in blockchain. Anything can happen. So the point is, we have to have a DApp Corda app, that is Corda app, which can talk to your Corda network. Otherwise, the Corda network will be useless. You cannot just use any sort of Corda network or Hyperledger or Ethereum. You cannot use all these technologies directly. You have to create some sort of UI layer in order to communicate, because maybe a network administrator is able to do, but not everyone, right? Then the main thing is, the main benefit of Corda network for participants is being able to move cash, digital assets, and identity data from one application to line of business to another. Probably in terms of, you can say, cryptocurrency. And the only cryptocurrency I believe currently works with R3 is XDC, which is from Ripple. And even 3 days back, they have declared that they are going to consume, and pretty soon be able to see that. Now, what are the four key services of Corda network? Is identity service, which provides this certification and all, network map service, notary service, and support service. Identity service basically controls admission of participants into Corda network, the way our MSP in Hyperledger, because it is a permissioned network, it is supposed to be there. The service receives certificate signing requests from prospective network participants, maybe sometimes via business network operator. Probably, let's say I want to establish a node in the current existing system. So that means I have to acquire a certificate from the current system. And then using that certificate, I can join the network. The participant meets the requirements specified in the bylaws and policies of the foundation. As I told you before, this contract, which is implemented in CODA, has to be bound by legal, you can say, or bound legally. So that is how you do business securely. In previous cases, yesterday, the way we discussed the contracts or the smart contracts discussed or coded over there are not legally bound, but with CODA, the contracts are legally bound. Right. The participant agrees to CODA network participant terms of use. That means that you have coded the rules. Let's say being a student in your college, there is a rule, student rule book, a student handbook. Certain things are written that you cannot wear certain things. You should come regularly to the classes. You should attend without doing some sort of noise or anything like that. You should submit your whatever the homework or whatever which you are given by your professors. So the point is, these are the agreement terms, and these agreement terms, whatever the node which is going to be attached to this particular network or he wants to attach itself, he has to follow. So the CODA network node can then use the participation certificate to register itself with the network map service. Network map service means you have achieved your certificate. Now you are going to register yourself using that certificate into your network map service. So network map service accepts digitally signed documents describing network routing and identifying information from nodes, and based on the participation certificate signed by the identity service, and makes this information available to all CODA network nodes. That means a new node, when a new node is added, the certification, based on the certification and all, every node will be informed, right? So that if any node wants to have some sort of transaction, that node has to be visible to all. As this is a public network, you can say this is a permission network, but as well as you are able to send the data and everything. That means if you are using cryptocurrency, that has to be a public network, but it is permission. That means you can acquire a certificate, but whenever you join, your node is supposed to be broadcast to the other users so that other users also are able to transact with your node. Notary service. So the CODA design separates correctness consensus from uniqueness consensus, and the latter is provided by one or more notary services. The notary will digitally sign a transaction presented to it, provided no transaction referring to any of the same inputs has been previously signed by the notary. That means your uniqueness or the correctness consensus. That means if a transaction is submitted again in terms of some malicious activity, if the transaction is already committed or the transaction is already signed by some other notary service or someone else, then it has to be corrected or it has to be verified. And that is why the time limit or the transaction timestamp is within the bounds and everything else. So the point is, it will check whether the transaction already signed within the timestamp or not. Second, business network operators and network participants may choose to enter into legal agreements. It is not compulsory, but if you have written something over there, it can be legally bound. And that is why it is written may choose to enter into legal agreements which rely on the presence of such digital signatures for determining whether a transaction to which they are party or upon the details of which they are otherwise rely is to be treated as confirmed. That means, let's say if you want to be a part of this network, and if you want to send some data, but you you don't want to be legally bound, so there is a possibility that you try to send some transaction or you try to do some mischievous activity, and because of that, this consensus mechanism is there. So the point is, it checks whether the transaction is already done or not, and that is the reason that if you want to keep yourself out of legal boundaries, you may or may not enter into legal agreements, right? Support service. The support service is provided to participants and business network operators to manage and resolve inquiries and incidents relating to identity service. That means basically your credentials in terms of license, in terms of certificate which you have got, whether is there any issue, you are not able to connect, you are not able to join the network, maybe you have some, even after joining, you are not able to, your node is not visible, you are not able to transmit or transfer any sort of currency or data to other nodes. All these services can, or all these issues can be solved or sorted out by support service. So main thing is every blockchain net, every blockchain technology has the core, at the core it has a network, because it's a distributed network every time. So CODA network is made up of nodes, of course, because every blockchain technology runs on that. Communication between these nodes is point to point and does not rely on global broadcast. So that means if I transfer 100 rupees to, let's say, Mr. X's account, then Mr. Y will not broadcast, or the entire network will not be aware that I have transferred some money to Mr. X's account. Each node has a certificate that maps his network identity to a real world global legal identity. That means I send the money, okay, but if it is not broadcast to the other people, then the legal issue or the security issue will be there in place. Let's say if I let's say some person wants to send some funds to some terrorist organizations, then it will be an issue for the government because it is not there. So that's why every node who is sending the data has to have that certificate which is mapped to the real world legal identity. The network is permissioned with access requiring a certificate from the network operator. How is the network structure of CODA? So that is, again, it is made up of nodes. Communication between is point to point. It's a certificate, permission. All communication is need to know basis, and all the nodes is in the network have the potential to communicate with other nodes. Now, why potential? Because as I told you before, the transactions, let's say there are two, three nodes involved in a transaction. So only those nodes will be able to see the transaction and not the every other node. But point is, if that is the case, then how to communicate? Then let's say if I cannot communicate with any other node, no, we can communicate to every node or each and every node from the network. And that is why it is said that the network, each and every node is capable or has the potential to communicate with other nodes. Because the connections on the graph do not have to be persistent on the networking level, CODA uses persistence queues. Now, what is a queue? I've told you yesterday also. Like if let's say there is a query from your user and your system is offline or your system is busy with some other request, then in most of the cases, wherever queue is not set up, the request gets discarded or you have to start all over again. But with this CODA structure, what you can do is you can have a queue over there. So that means every request, even if your system is offline, the request will be processed once your system will be online. And by that time, the data will be stored in a queue. Now, queues can be of 1 GB, 2 GB, 10 GB. It depends on your network's capacity to handle. Probably most of the times, the data stored in a queue, if we talk about Azure, then Azure bus queues or Azure queues can store the data for 14 days, depend on the settings parameter. You can keep the data for 4 days, 5 days, 7 days, 10 days, up to you, but maximum it can be hold over there for 14 days. After that, because it has a limited amount of storage, it has to do that, otherwise the queue will be full. So what happens is, even if you are offline, the transaction, let's say I have sent some money to some node and that node is currently offline, the transaction will be held in a queue. And as soon as the node comes online, the data, the transaction will take place. Now, identities. So in discovery, so the point is, as we discussed earlier, every node is a single well-known identity. This identity is used to represent the node in transaction. Because it is legally bound, it has to be that way, otherwise it will be an issue. And because of node is like attached to an IP address, because you have to have a legal identity, and that can be done using this IP address. And these IP addresses are used for messaging between nodes. So yesterday we saw that there is a technology called Solo and Kafka. If you are dealing with one node, multiple organization, then you are using Solo, as we have seen yesterday. But if you are using multi-node, multi-part organizations, then you are supposed to use Kafka. And this Kafka can handle the node, the messaging transfer between or among the nodes. But here, IP addresses are used for messaging between nodes. Nodes can also generate confidential identities for individual transaction. So the certificate chain linking to a confidential identity to a well-known known identity or real-world legal identity is only distributed on a need-to-know basis. So once again, the similar story, again and again, that whenever you do a transaction, it has to be a confirmed identity. It has to generate a confirmed identity. And based on that, only the transaction can happen. Plus, it is confidential because only the concerned parties are able to see the transaction. Currently, what is happening in Ethereum or Bitcoin or any other network, the entire network is visible to everyone. That means you have transferred money to X, to Y, to Z, to any other party in the world. Entire block structure is available. Everybody can see that how much coin or how much money is transferred from this wallet to that wallet. Your identity is confidential, but your transactions are visible. Here, the identity and the transaction also is confidential, right? So if confidential identities are being used, this ensures that even if an attacker gets access to an unencrypted transaction, they cannot identify the transaction's participant without additional information. That means if somebody somehow manages to identify a transaction or to unencrypted transaction, let's say it is not possible, but hypothetically, let's say if that is possible, so without any additional information, because if the node is not involved in particular those two nodes and the identities of those two nodes are completely confidential, then the transaction will be useless to that particular attacker because it will not be able to identify that which are the two nodes involved in this particular transaction. Now, of course, because it is a DLT, ledger has to be there. So the ledger is subjective from each peer's perspective. Now, this is a very interesting sentence. In other cases, we have seen the ledger is not perspective. Sorry, the ledger is not subjective, but here it is subjective. Why? Because need to know basis. That is why every node has different sort of data. Two peers are always guaranteed to see the exact same version of any ledger facts that they share. Now, this can create a different set of issue. Now, can anyone tell me that what sort of issue can happen within this? Anyone? It says only two peers are always guaranteed to see the exact same version of any ledger facts they share. That means every node is different. So what problem can occur within this CODA network? Anyone?
Is there any possibility of duplication of the things because as such all the nodes are individually dealing with the network networks and all?
So you mean to say in Hyperledger Fabric, if I remove a node or in Ethereum, I remove a node, I can recreate the node and I can still have the data. My data will not be lost, right?
Yeah.
But in this case, the data can be lost because let's say if C and D nodes are connected, if C nodes get deleted, then maybe the D node can provide the data to it. But C has transacted to F node, D, the other nodes also. So if one particular node gets deleted, it will be an issue. It will not be pretty much similar to the blockchain, other blockchain networks. Then what will be done? All the transactions are even like mapped in terms of network map service. And then based on that network map service, you can have a backend. We can have a, you can say, what do you say? Backup storage. And from that backup, you can retrieve the data. So technically it doesn't work exactly the same in terms of blockchain. And that is why R3 CODA sometimes is not considered as complete blockchain network. It is considered as a partial blockchain network so that it removes certain things. It even lacks certain things in terms of this backup or in terms of nodes or in terms of sharing the entire amount of data set. So that is how the ledger of R3 CODA is different than other ledgers. As I told you, as we discussed earlier, in CODA, there is no single central store of data. So instead, each node maintains its own database of those facts that it is aware of. And that is why this thing is there, as I discussed before, that you have to have a backup in terms of all the transactions. Otherwise, there will be an issue if some particular node gets deleted. Now, let us just see an example. If there are nodes representing Alice and Bob on the network, Alice loans some money to Bob. Both Alice and Bob will store an identical record of the facts about the loan. So two parties involved, Alice and Bob. Let's say Julie is the third person in this particular network, and Julie will not be able to see the transactions happened between Alice and Bob. So now let us see how that works. So here you can see that Alice and Bob have done some transactions. So 1 and 7, these are common, both the things are done. Then Carl, same goes with Demi and Ed. So Demi and Ed is 8 and 3. Demi and Carl is 2 and 3. Carl and Ed is 9 and 4. And then Carl and Bob is 5 and 6. So the predicting Venn diagram represents 5 nodes: Alice, Bob, Carl, Demi, and Ed as sets. When the sets overlap, are shared facts such as we already said that Alice and Bob 1 and 7 transactions. Same way Bob and Carl 5 and 6 transactions. That means the transaction happened here. The transaction happened 1 and 7 because one, let's say, is the transaction of Alice, and the same identical transaction in terms of 7 is with Bob. So that transaction will not be visible to Carl, Ed, and Demi because they are not part of that particular transaction. So there are no omniscient peers like Ethereum in Hyperledger, which can see everything on the ledger. Each node sees their own facts and the facts that they share with others, right? So shared facts, as we have seen, that the data shared is not visible to other networks, other nodes. What sort of transactions? Let's say this is the case, Alice and Bob. There are 4 transactions, 1, 7, 6, 5. And the facts in terms of 1 is much consensus. 1 is common between Alice and Bob, so 1 is visible to both. The other, Bob also can see much consensus. 7 is so bilateral. 7 is so bilateral, so it is visible to both of them, Alice and Bob, because it is 1, 7. So it is this and this one. But number 6, that is very fact, which is done by Bob, is not visible to Alice. And number 5 or number 11, let's say Wow Ledger. So that is not overwritten over here, but that is again not visible to Bob because it is not listed over there. And number 5 is Amaze Network over here. It is not again visible to Alice. So the point is, only transactions which happened between Alice and Bob are visible to both. The transactions happened between some other nodes and Bob, or some other node and Alice, is not visible to Bob or not visible to Alice. Consensus, basically that is required. So to be committed, transactions must achieve both validity and uniqueness. Uniqueness, again, we have seen that how it spots the double spending attack and it can prevent that. And validity consensus requires contractual validity of the transaction and all its dependencies in terms of the smart contract, which they have implemented in the beginning while starting the CODA network. There are 2 types of consensus in particular CODA, whether validity consensus is the process of checking that the following conditions hold both for the proposed transaction and for every transaction in the transaction chain that generated the inputs to the proposed transaction. So it's accepted by the contracts of every input and output state, and transaction has all the required signatures. That means all the validations in normal application, let's say I'm registering myself on particular website, then the validations are, my username has to be this long, my password has to have this sort of characters, my email ID has to be proper, my whatever username I'm setting has to be unique enough. So all these validations which are supposed to be used in order to run a business, those validations are done by validity consensus, right? So, and then when verifying a proposed transaction, a given party may not have every transaction in the transaction chain, and they need to verify. In this case, they can request the missing transactions from the transaction proposers. So let's say here, Charlie issues cash to Dan over here. So signed, issued to Dan. Alice swaps a bond, Dan for cash, So the same transaction happened again with a different signing authority, and then Alice pays cash to Bob settling the $10 IOU. So let's what happened is there are multiple transactions happened between Dan, then Alice, and again Bob. So what this case, in this case, they can request the missing transaction. Transaction proposer will always have the full transaction chain. Here you can see this one, pay and settle. So what happened is Alice pays cash to Bob, and then it goes to here, and then it goes to here, issue. So the point is Dan and Alice, the transaction happened, one gave the other, and they settled in terms of friend. I mean, you have taken money from one friend and you want to have, you want to, you are like, you are owing somebody to your, some money to your other friend, and other friend your gives money to your current friend, so that it is terms of settlement. So it is the same sort of transaction happened over here. But the point is, whenever the proposer of the transaction started the transaction, it was not, or he or she was not aware of the entire set of transactions. And in that case, the transaction proposer has to be aware of the entire set of transaction. Maybe in our case, let's say when I give some money to my friend, and that my friend is supposed to give me back, but that my friend owes some money to someone else, and that someone else needs to give me money. Now that someone else needs to give me money, because he is not aware of that, because that someone else owns money to my friend, Mr. A. And A owes some money to B. So B has to return some money to A. Now B is not aware of this entire transaction, that B has to give me money. And that is how this transaction takes place. And whenever these things happens, the proposed, that means I have to know these transactions, otherwise it will be an issue. Then uniqueness consensus. So let's say, as I told you before, that let's say some money is being held in somebody's account. In this case, Bob has some $1 million in his account, and then a transaction transferring $1 million to Charlie in exchange of eight lakh pounds, and then transaction transferring same amount of money to Dan with $9 million some other currency. So the point is, this is a problem. Why? Because Bob spent the money twice, one to Dan and once to Charlie. This is not possible. In banks, it is not possible, because at the same time, the money gets transferred. So your account is less by that much money. So for banks, it is not possible. For currencies, cryptocurrencies, it is possible. Why? Because the money is in terms of cryptocurrency, as a digital money. So probably it is possible. And that is why it is unique, because every transaction takes, in normal transaction takes 8 minutes to take place. So meanwhile, you can do that. And that is the reason this uniqueness consensus comes in the picture, and it stops this sort of double spending attacks or double spending, you can say, tries. This is how it works. Alice issues cash to Bob. Same thing, Bob cash to Charlie, Bob sends cash to Dan and everything. So prevent this, a valid transaction proposal must also achieve uniqueness consensus. And it is the requirement that none of the inputs have to be a proposed transaction have already been consumed. That means over here, let's say this transaction happened. Bob sends cash to Charlie, Bob sends cash to Dan. Now here, what happens is the same money cannot go to both the things, both the persons. So the transaction which happened first time, if it is done, then it cannot be done again. That transaction is marked completed. The transaction is valid transaction, and then transaction is consumed, that is marked, and that transaction level or the transaction number cannot be used again for Dan. And that is how it stops. That once, as I told you before, that if you have 15 rupees and you have to give 10 rupees to someone else, then 15 rupees will be transferred, 5 rupees will be back in terms of an unspent transaction, and 10 rupees will be transferred to that. So that what you do is your 10 rupees transaction is marked confirmed, and that transaction number cannot be used again. That means you cannot use that 10 rupees again, you have to use the remaining 5 rupees. So these are the different sources from where I have taken the, you can say, context. Now let us go to demo part. So for demo, you can download this project over here from this particular link, gitlab.com/devcoda/ccd/IOU. And from there, you have to run this command. Which one? A very simple git command, git clone, and you pass this ID. And as soon as you pass this ID, something like this, this folder structure will be automatically done. And once you log in with that particular folder structure, or you have to open that particular folder using IntelliJ, you will be presented something like this. So CCDIOU is a folder from which I have cloned this entire project, this one, all right? So this is the terminal, same the way we used for studio code, the same terminal, same sort of terminal is over here. Now, yesterday we saw that you have to do a tremendous amount of activities before starting the network. For Ethereum also, you have to join the main network and download a huge amount of data before even starting something on mainnet. For Robston and Rinkeby, you can start immediately, but for proper networks, you have to synchronize everything on there. But for this, it is very simple. You download that particular application, you press this button, run contrast tests, or debug core app, or run template code app, this one. When you run this one, first one will have test. As soon as it is done, it will install everything, it will test for everything, and it will install everything. When you run template code app, it will install the remaining dependencies. So you don't need to check for what is required, what is not required, what library should be installed, what is supposed to be checked, what is supposed to be set as a path. No need to worry, this will take care of everything. That is the easing part of it. You need Kotlin or Java setup in your machine. You need IntelliJ. You need Postgres SQL database. But currently, you don't need to set up anything. Just run this and run the following commands in the way it is mentioned in readme.md. So for Windows, it is this one, deploy nodes. For Ubuntu, the same thing, but in a different way. Just deploy nodes. It will take some time, so let us wait till that time. IntelliJ is basically an editor. You can check over here, IntelliJ. You can download the community edition. This one. And you can download. No, do not go for Ultimate. Just go for a community, because Ultimate is a licensed piece. But you can use this community edition for free lifetime, and it works perfectly fine. So 95%, now the entire execution is done. Build is successful in 33 seconds, 14 actionable tasks and 4 executed, 10 up to date. Maybe you have a different figure when you deploy this on your machine. Then run the network. So run the network is build nodes, run nodes, batch file. So just copy that command over here and press enter. This will open 3 different windows of Java. Now let us see what happens or what is visible in these 3 windows one by one. I believe the font size is small, but I'll just narrate what is happening over here, so you will be able to see or understand. I can rather properties. Yes, I can increase the font size. Yes, it is now visible. So as you can see, what is this started? Notary node. So this service, this particular code will start 3 nodes. One is a notary node, because that is required to finalize the transaction. And the other 2 nodes are, one is what? Your party A node, and the other is your party B node. But somehow party B node is not working. It is just saying listening for transport DT socket and address. It is supposed to work on 3 different nodes in a 3. Here it is notary, that is fine. Here it is party A. Yes, party A is there. So as you can see, party A is there. Font is 24 rather. Okay, so party A is also there, but party B is somehow not working. I don't know what is the issue with there, but let's say I just want to run this command. So I'll go to this party A console, and this is a notary console. So I'll go to party A console. I'll copy that command. So as you can see, the IOU flow is started. It transfers value, or it loans the 50 rupees to the other party, party B. Now it is collecting signatures from counterparties. So that is the thing which is going on. Here it is, I don't know why it is not listening, but let us just try that command over here once this is finished. But this will not be finished because it is trying to collect signatures from the counterparties and the counterpart node is not working. This node, it has to work in terms of party A, party B and notary. So let us just try again. Let us just deploy nodes again, and hopefully this time we will be able to see three different nodes. Now somehow the third node keeps on destroying it. It's not working. So practically the transaction will not be finished if this happens. Keep on listening. So just give me a moment. Let me fix if it is possible for me to fix. It is no error. It is the 707 party B is also started. Let us start from a new directory. So mkdir new. And hover cd new, and here I will type down the command git clone. What was the command? Okay, now let us just open this project folder. Is the same thing I've opened. Exit. Let us start again. Just give me a moment. Let us see if it is fixable. In the morning when I started this, it was working perfectly fine. I don't know why it is not working right now. Let us deploy once again. So node directories are generated, notary, party A, party B, all is done. It is supposed to work now. Yes, done. today it has decided to go against me and it is not working. So this node has to work in order for me to show you that how it communicates between nodes. Otherwise, I will not be able to show you the transaction. The demo was when I try to register a transaction using party A node, the automatic transaction gets recorded and the notary identifies both the nodes, and the same transaction once you query will be able to, you will be able to see in this node also, which is a party B node. As you can see, this is a party A node over here and this is a notary node. Right, so I'll not take much of your time. I'm sorry for the demo did not work, but if you follow these instructions, it will work properly. Maybe some issue with the machine or some I need to restart, but restarting will take time. I'll disconnect for a while, but it is Windows, so a restart will definitely solve the problem and I'll be able to, or maybe fire in a while, and you guys can check because it is not much installation is required. It downloads the dependencies on its own and you are good to go. Okay, so it is my presentation is over. So thank you very much everyone for the time. And if you have any questions, please go ahead.
Any participant has any question?
Sunil sir, is there any specific requirement for what you can say that the machines through which we can do all such type of transaction and all? Because
For R3 Corda and IOTA, no. For Hyperledger Fabric, yes, because you have to install Docker, so virtualization has to be enabled and all. For Ethereum, again, no. So for public networks, no. For private permission networks, if you are installing on Docker, then yes, virtualization is required. You can enable it from your BIOS settings. When you start your laptop or computer, there is a specific setting, like say F12 or F10 key. If you keep on tapping that key, BIOS settings will be opened. And from there, you have to enable virtualization.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Thank you very much.
Any other question?
No, sir. So, sir, on behalf of all the GEC pattern family members, as well as all the other participants, I would like to thank Mr. Sunil Kapadia, sir, for sharing his valuable knowledge with all of us since last 2 days. I would like to specifically mention one thing. Sir has already tried to cover all such things, very informative sessions in a very lucid manner. And the important as well as very interesting thing was that sir has already given the live demonstration of that thing, which was really very interesting thing. Sir has just tried to cover, started from Hyperledger Fabric's IOTA concept, as well as today what sir has given the idea about that Corda structures and everything. It was really very nice as well as very productive session. So once again, sir, thank you very much on behalf of all of us. Thank you once again, sir.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you. Thank you for being such a wonderful audience. I hope I was able to cater all the requirements or all the possible information you required to start these things. And I'm saying that anyone wants to be in touch with me in terms of any of these technologies, please feel free to contact me. Payal has all the details through which you can contact. I'm on LinkedIn also. So you can even connect over there and we can like share ideas. We can build something in future. So once again, thank you very much for inviting me.
Yes, yes. Thank you very much, sir. That's so nice of you, sir. Thank you very much,
sir, for your valuable time and effective knowledge.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Payal, I'll share both the PPTs and I'll share the demo video also after a while. So that this entire whatever the demo was not work or did not work, I'll record a demo and I'll record a session and I'll pass on that video to you so you can share among your peers.
Yes,
thank you so much, sir. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone. Bye bye and have a nice day.
Bye. Yes. Thank
Same
you, sir.
To you, sir. To all the participants, we'll meet at 2 p.m. There is a session of Pujya Gyanvatsal Swamiji. So I would request that no one will interrupt in between. If you have any question, if you want to ask something, if you have any suggestion, you please type in the chat box. The representative will ask on behalf of you. Okay. Thank you. Link will be shared.